Chapter 40, The Road to 39 East Galena. Pay the bills first, Tony told Ted. Work for yourself, and you always have a job. Tony taught Ted and Joe how to paint cars. He taught them to paint feather edge. Tony was meticulous. You didn't touch anything twice. You did it right the first time. After Ted and Joe washed a car, Tony examined the windows right to the edges to be sure there were no streaks. To Tony, any job you did to the best of your ability. It made me think of the stonemasons who put as much care into carving the gargoyles destined to sit high atop the cathedral as he did the statues destined to be placed at eye level. He carved for the eye of God. Tony instilled that work ethic in his sons. He told Ted back home when they hired someone to work on the farm, "We work the hardest to set the pace." He taught Ted and Joe to be the pace setters for the employees. For a time, there was only one place in town anyone dared have a luxury car painted, and that was Tony Leskovar's. After painting a car, they saved all the paper they used to mask the windows to reuse on the next car. They never threw anything out that could be reused. When there was a little bit of paint left over, not enough for a car, they mixed it with other bits of paint and painted a used car with it. One day, a woman came in with a purple purse and said she wanted her car painted to match her purse. They mixed paint to create the color. She was delighted. "We did two completes a day," Ted said. "Each cost $35. Tony paid Joe and Ted each $100 a week. They worked from 9 in the morning to 4:30 in the afternoon, Monday through Friday. Those were the hours dictated by the painters' union. At lunchtime, Ted would run out and buy hamburgers at Greasy Gus's and bring them back, 4 hamburgers, 2 for him and 2 for Joe. Tony dined at a restaurant up the street. After a big lunch, he was sleepy. Pops would be taking a nap in one of the cars, Ted said. Somebody would come in looking for him, and we'd find him sleeping, and we wouldn't bother him. Back around 1949 or 1950, Ted Wellman, the Dodge dealer, told Tony that he could use the upstairs of his building at 39 East Galena to start a paint shop. He could have it rent-free for the first 6 months. Of course, Tony took the offer. The Dodge dealership was on the ground floor. Wellman owned the building. This was uptown near the line, the red light district. There were cribs up the block across the street. The paint shop was on the second floor. Ted or Joe or Tony would drive the car up the ramp and make a sharp turn at the top. They had to be skillful drivers, not to scrape the cars. Wellman operated his body shop on the second floor, so to be precise, Tony leased all of the second floor except the body shop. In 1955, Tony signed a 3-year lease with Wellman for the upstairs paint shop for $175 a month. When Wellman quit the body shop business, the Leskovars took that over. Now they operated a paint and body shop. They had a contract with the post office to do body work. They'd repair the vehicle by the next day. They also had a contract to pull out mail trucks that were stuck in the snow. "How did you do it?" "We had a pickup," Ted said. "We hooked up a chain and took a run at it. Just a 2-wheel drive pickup." Around 1956, Babe left Wilson's to work for Tony. Tony and Babe had a difficult father-son relationship, and it didn't improve by working together. Ted and Joe had different temperaments. They were able to roll with Tony's capricious ways. Music would always come first for Tony. He was first and foremost a musician. Gifted artists can be difficult. Tony was gifted and difficult. Ted and Joe understood that, and he was their father. When there was any slack from any direction, Ted and Joe picked it up. They took to heart the work ethic Tony instilled in them. They worked as owners, not as employees. This letter is from Annie to son Eddie and daughter-in-law Louise in Seattle, dated January 8, 1957. Dear Louise and Ed, We'll write a quick letter, as I don't know what to write about, rushing to the shop, making out the estimates, or rather copy them, to be taken to the insurance company. Jobs are coming in fast, and Joe does most of the painting. It is impossible to get a good painter, and also, being sober, have now three body men working on wrecked car. Tony is planning taking the downstairs also. I guess the rent will be around $500. And speaking of Tony, he is all right. I guess the mean was coming out of him. Babe and Joe would like to see Tony away from the shop. He is too darn bossy. But he can help. But gets me, he sure rushes the paint job, and Joe has to keep on spraying. If Joe gets sick, I do wonder sometimes who is going to do the work. Since Joe has been doing or is doing the painting, we get lots of compliments. Also, we do have a lot of competition. The weather during Christmas and New Year's was surprisingly warm, as you would call it banana weather. Now it is getting colder and very cold. Louise, how long did you have to stay in the hospital? Hoping everything will come to a happy day. I do want to thank Carol and Mary Lou for their nice note. I presume Johnny is studying hard in high school. How is he making out in the music or in the band? At Christmas, we had turkey dinner at Babe's. Helen's mother and family called from Chicago while we were having our dinner. It was at 6 p.m. Butte time. We all had tears in our eyes, and it did kind of spoil our dinner. For me, it was good, or I would have kept on for a third helping. New Year's Day had dinner at Joe's, baked ham this time. Believe me, I have gained quite a bit. Sunday, Ted went back to school. He was disappointed of his report card. He got C's and C+. He did expect to get B's in his accounting. It means that he will have to study harder. He moved out of the Craig Hall and moved to a private home. They have rooms for students, and if you want to write to him, his address is 610 Eddy Street. This is all for now. We'll get ready and go up to the shop. So happy New Year to you all, Anne. Ted did study harder and bumped up those accounting grades to A's. In 1957, the Army notified Ted that he was going to be drafted. He'd rather be a pilot, so he applied for the Air Force. Though he had perfect vision, he couldn't pass the vision test. His eyes had become muscle-bound from studying. The doctor told him he needed to look away periodically when reading to allow his eyes to adjust. Even so, the doctor wouldn't clear him for flight school. Ted opted for the Army Reserves. He put college on hold, and off he went to Fort Ord, California for basic training. He was part of a test group that did all physical training double time. He learned to be a marksman and trained for the Signal Corps, climbing up telephone poles to string phone lines. Tony's landlord, Wellman, moved the Dodge dealership to Montana Street. That left the ground floor showroom and parts and service department at 39 East Galena empty. Tony was afraid Wellman would sell the building out from under him and he'd have to relocate. So he rented the whole place, even though he didn't need it. It was a stretch to afford it. This was the summer of 1957. Wellman asked Joe if they would be willing to buy the building for $25,000. Wellman, the payments would be $2,500 a month. Joe, can't afford it. Wellman, how about $1,500 a month? Joe, can't afford it. Wellman, $1,000. Joe, can't afford it. Wellman, $250. Joe, we can do that. An attorney wrote it up. It was less than what they'd been paying in rent. Soon after, a man from the Ford Motor Company came to town and offered the Edsel franchise to Wellman. He declined. Talk to Leskovar's, he said. They have an empty showroom. Tony had no money with which to buy the franchise. The Edsel people went to Metals Bank and looked at the financial statement. Joe and Ted and Bay put everything they could into Tony's assets to bump up the balance sheet. They had no working capital. Letter from Annie, not dated, Sunday. Dear Louise and Ed and all. I'm using Ted's writing material. I should have written before, but have been very busy. Monday, the fellows from Ford Company from Spokane and Seattle came in, and I had to rush with financial report for the bank and for the Ford Company in Dearborn, Michigan. The truth of all this deal, we didn't care if we got it if we were not going to be enthusiastic about the deal or about the Metals Bank giving them money for the floor plan is money for the cars to be sold, of which will be about 6 cars. So what happens? Bank approves the loan for 6 cars, about $2,500, and a loan of $5,000 extra working capital. Gosh, I didn't know what to say. I guess it made Tony happy to think he has credit with the bank. They have asked Tony if he wanted $50,000. Tony said no. The smaller is the loan, the quicker it would be paid. The business in painting and body shop has slackened down a little. July, the production of building the Edsel cars will be delivered to the dealers in August. Now Tony is waiting to hear from the Ford company in Dearborn if he gets the dealership. Glad to hear the little darling Ronald is doing fine. You didn't mention about his cold. Did he get over it? You know, we have enjoyed ourselves very much with you all. I'm sure Stephen Zelda did also. Also with your folks. It was really enjoying 2 or 3 or 4 grandma and grandpas got together and Tony had someone to talk to. I hope next year, if everything goes well, that all meet together. Your mother and dad and us and Stephen Zelda. Nothing much of news. It is all quiet on the Western Front, excepting the blasting that shakes the house from the open pit. It is raining. The weather has been cold since we came home. About molds for ceramics. They came in good shape. Have been very busy lately, so no time for ceramics. If Tony gets the dealership, the whole shop must be cleaned up and painted. Joe was saying something about visiting you people, so I don't know what his plans are. He doesn't know himself what he is going to do. I think he should stay home and finish up the house and move in. I guess this is all for now. Best regards to all. Ann. About Johnny, Eddie and Louise's eldest son, coming over here to work in the shop. What do you think about it? Do you think he is too young yet? We'll close now. Best regards to all. Ann. I'm pleased to have the opportunity of selling the most remarkable car in the country today, the Edsel, Tony said in an ad in the Montana Standard. There never has been a car like the Edsel. Prices started as low as $2,642.50 for the two-door Ranger sedan. The business was now called Leskovar Motors Sales and Service. They continued to operate the paint and body shop. Old habits are hard to break, and some don't need to be broken. We would always refer to it as the shop, since it began as a paint shop. In the fall of 1957, Tony traveled to Helena to perform with the symphony orchestra. Now he's up in Helena again, and again, and again. Whenever the conductor needed a bassoonist, he hired Tony. Tony was a dedicated, disciplined, conscientious musician. He never passed up a gig. Until the day he died, he never stopped practicing. The consummate professional, he. Even when Tony and Annie visited Eddie and Louise and the children in Seattle, Tony brought his bassoon and practiced in the basement. Ted returned from basic training at the end of December 1957. He lived at home with his parents and resumed doing the books at the shop. They were a mess. It would take some time for him to get them in shape. Finishing college would have to wait. In July of 1958, Leskovars won the Edsel sales contest. The prize was an all-expense-paid trip for Tony and Annie to San Francisco. They sold more Edsels than any other dealer in Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and Montana. Tony never sold cars himself. He left the running of the shop and the tasks of selling and painting cars in the able hands of his sons. Annie worked in the office. When a customer came into the showroom, she rang a bell, which rang upstairs where Ted and Joe were painting a car. One of them would take off his coveralls, underneath of which he wore slacks, a dress shirt, and tie, and he'd hurry down to wait on the customer.